Informative webinar is on Agro Spectrum and Maharashtra Economic Development Council. So as we all know that Indian fisheries remain an important sector of food production, providing nutritional security besides livelihood support and gain employment to more than 14 million people and contributing to agriculture exports. It has been showing a steady growth in the total GDP and account for around 6.58% of GDP from agriculture, forestry and fishing. However, the COVID-19 lockdown period has impacted fishery sector a lot. It has completely devastated the fishermen community and like many other sectors in India. So besides that, there have been huge losses also, I've heard, in processing industry and export and other nodes of value chain. Government is taking major steps in announcing various schemes to help the sector. As we all know that government allocated ₹20,000 crore for fishermen through the Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana. This was the part of the government's economic package to help rejuvenate India's economy. As much as ₹11,000 crore out of ₹20,000 crore is kept for activities in marine, inland fisheries and aquaculture. Meanwhile, the rest of 9,000 crore, as we all know, for creating infrastructure such as fishing, harbour, cold chains and market. However, there is a need of guidance from experts for showing way to every factor of the sector. And that is the purpose of organizing this webinar. So without delaying further, I would like to introduce a team from AgroVision Foundation. We have Mr. Ravindra Gadodkar. He is the President, AgroVision Foundation. And he is also the publisher of Agro Spectrum and New Food Spectrum. We have Dr. C. D. Mai. He is the chairman of AgroVision Advisory Committee. And today we also have a distinguished panel for this session. In a fundamental sense, introduction. So I'll be very brief. And without further ado, I would like to welcome all our panelists. So I welcome Shri Mahesh Deore. He is a Joint Commissioner, Inland Fisheries, Department of Fisheries, Government of Maharashtra. Dr. is the Director, Central Indian Fisheries Research Institute. Dr. Ravi Shankar, Director, ICRCIFT, that is Central Institute of Fisheries Technology. Dr. Debajit Sharma, Director, ICAR, Directorate of Cold Water Fisheries Research, Bhimtal. Shri Maruti Upare is a former General Manager of NABARD and former Rural Credit Expert, FAO and the World Bank. So I would now like to request Mr. Ravi Boratkar for his opening remarks. Mr. Boratkar.
Yeah, good morning and a warm greeting from AgroVision Foundation, AgroSpectrum and Maharashtra Economic Development Council. As you all know, under the leadership of Honorable Shri Nitinji Gadkari and Dr. C.D. Mai, who is with us today, we have been doing this AgroVision for almost last one decade. In the past few years, we have also done programs about this development of inland fisheries. So I'm happy today to welcome a very distinguished panel which comprises of very experienced and senior scientists who have rich experience in this sector. We also have policy makers with us from the central as well as the state government. And we also have a person from finance background, which is key for any such commercial or a business venture or for financial viability. And we also have some experienced and those who are doing good practice, those who have the experience as farmers, successful farmers joining us today. So we. And I would also like to welcome all my attendees today for this challenges, opportunities, and remain a traditional activity. Yes, attention of things yet to come. And fisheries depends on new technologies, innovative production technologies, and limit students to distinguished panel and guys who are keenly interested actor. Given a keen on the sector and also the fish production, and you bringing out the real challenges or the opportunities will be a great inspiration to I think. Viva, can you hear me?
Viva, please continue, Viva.
She has her mic.
Viva. Problem with this Webex.
And maybe till the time Viva joins, Mr. Das, may I request you to
Mr. Das? Give
you... Yeah, Mr. Das, you can start.
Because I'm finding us a little late. So I think Mr. Das.
Fine.
Welcome, sir.
I can see all of you. I don't know whether you can see me or not, but I can see you.
Now we can see you. So nice. Welcome, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Pratkar, for your opening remarks. There were some technical glitches I believe you all were fixing. So I welcome you all again. And last, I'll start this panel discussion with Dr. B.K. Das. So, sir, as you know about the topic today is that challenges, opportunities in India. So, what, according to you, are the challenges that we are facing? What are the opportunities, and how do you see our future in this inland fisheries?
Hello.
We can hear you. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. Looking into the scenario of inland fisheries, if you look into this, most of the inland sector today are governed by livelihood aspect. So, except few pockets of India where we go for aquaculture practices, other things. You look into that, we are mostly going for the livelihood aspect of the fishermen. Looking into the production, I don't believe, because if you see inland sector contribute around 80%, 70% of the total fish productions. Out of that, if you see inland fisheries, like you have the rivers, mangroves, estuaries, brackish water lagoons, or large medium reservoirs and small reservoirs, and wetland, floodplain wetlands, they only contribute 1 million metric tons only, the fish productions. But the diversity is very huge. People say diversity is very huge. India is bestowed with so much number of fish. When you talk with other countries, maybe one species, tilapia or pangasius or salmon, they concentrate all these things. But when you work with this, we have many constraints. We look into the indigenous carp, which is a aquaculture practice. Again, the breeding, other things. Though we speak, yeah, we have more than 50 species. Breeding has been standardized, available. But in practice, you could see only 7-8 species that are bred and in all the departments, only the carp and other few species are is being go for in a large scale. Even if we are talking about the pangasius and hypothalamus, it's a high production fish. Again, that is going to, we see most of the seed bring from Bangladesh, other things, and few hatcheries are established. And again, the cage culture, inland cage culture is one of the bigger aspect of the challenges. Today, so far, we only 18,000 some odd cage has been installed across the India. If you look into the large and medium reservoirs of the country, the potential of cage culture is very huge. If you're taking 0.1% of the area and the productivity that is yield. Again, if you look into the small reservoirs, and that can be go for the culture-based fisheries. Culture-based fisheries means increasing the production, enabling the productivity, maybe macrovegetations and chlorophyll, and we are finding out the carrying capacity. Based on, you can increase the production of these small reservoirs to a greater extent, which can solve the livelihood. Again, all these things, we have the challenges like governance pattern, ownership, then again this, the willing to carry the things, conflict, so many things. Again, every state, because it's a fishery, it's a state chapter, in individual states have the leasing policy, other things, which are the water bodies. Again, if you'll see, most of the, if you will take a Telangana as example, the large water bodies or medium large water bodies, they are solved as a drinking purpose also. We cannot impose large scale practice of culture, again, only releasing some fingerlings. Again, the getting a fingerlings as a desired size is one of the challenges in the present day. Why? Because if you say that we advise, if we advise 100 mm stocking density in the reservoir, but most of the states, if you go to the 100 mm size, it is difficult to get in the stocking in the reservoir. There, the productivity, all the time we talk, it is good. Even in Chhattisgarh, is the one of the inland state which is excel in this reservoir production, other things. There you will see also, if you will see, we have studied this stocking impact. They, every year they forecast that 2,000 fingerlings of 180 to 120 mm they stocks, but hardly they get a production of only 300 kg per hectare productions. So if you calculate this thing, again, this is also low productivity than the reservoirs. Again, if you go to the wetland productions in the Assam, the demonstration, because our technology pen culture, which is in situ fingerlings, and there you will see around they have achieved up to 1,000 kg per hectare. So these are the some of the technology which advanced from the chipri technology, which is ready to adaptation and the in situ rearing, that can help to boost the productions from the the wetlands and the small reservoirs, which is maybe 16 lakhs hectares, around 16.71 lakhs hectares of small reservoirs. If we go in a strategic manner of 10% adoption in the every year, we can at least we can get a productions of maybe that is required that for the doubling the productions of the country and at the Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana. Again, if you see the large and medium reservoirs, that can be only the cage cultures beside some of the because the productivity is the large rivers is 50 kg today. And if you look into the large and medium river reservoirs in the country, around 18 lakhs hectare. So it is a huge. Again, if you see at least 10 kg, if you go for a cumulative growth for each and strategic planning for this technology, then we have the policy, then it can be a huge production to become add to this. Again, estuary, we don't look into the estuary. It is a breeding ground, everything for all aspects. And estuary is, we have like a Ugulmatral estuary, you will pay. Even the average income of the fisherman from the Ugulmatral estuary is 10,000 rupees. And very low, because the small fishing, juvenile fishing has gone rampantly, breeding ground has lost. Recruitment agent. If you compare with like a chilka, if you see chilka is a just like a self-replicating model. It's a only the dug out of a outer channel. The productions and productivity 10,000 crores comes from the fisheries. Again, equally tourism from 10,000 crores. Another 10,000 crores. So this type of like, if you see some of the protected and large water body, like other things, which is a strategic management and it is a large body to be formed to regulate and increase the productivity. All these things may be improving upon total ICT based systems to increase the production of all these water bodies. Looking into this synergy, this is strength is huge. Challenges, we have challenged because of so many aspects I told, discussed. Then opportunity, if you look into this, there is a tremendous opportunity to look into the biodiversity and other things we can increase. Though we don't have a fisherman census and we are, ministry is asked to do some fisherman census, we are working on that. If we have a fisherman census, inland fisherman census right in place, it will be very easy to go for all the strategic planning and development aspect in the sector, because we are talking about the 2001 census, that is maybe 14 million people they say, but if you see today, every state beyond that, the things. Again, we do, again, if you see river and streets, all of you know, due to dams and barrages, the environmental flow of all the rivers has lost today. Maybe exotics has dominated certain packets. Pockets and the, where they are built of dams and various reservoirs, you will find some of the fish are there. If in the huge biodiversity in the reservoirs, other things, and likewise many of the fish of its taste and flavor. So we have to look into these systems, not for the productions, but for the productivity increasement as well as the livelihood. Because if you see most of the fishers' income from these river and sources, hardly 3,000 to 5,000 rupees. So this is in the present day of contest, the income is very less. It's a very less to sustain these resources. We require again ranching programs, which will increase some specific fish in the ranching. That will increase the productivity of the rivers. Ranching is not that somewhere the inbred fish. Again, we have to look into the fish that should collect from the riverine resources. We'll have do only one breeding. Then we'll next for the next furthers. Then we require a specific human force to do, not the existing nursery. If the existing hatchery is there, we have to earmark where to collect in the river banks. Then that will be happen for these things. Again, cage culture, which I told, inland cage culture. The species diversification is one of the aspects because you have a lot of species. Like pangas, like if you see pangas in some country, some part of the state have a more than 100 rupees is per market price. If we compare it to Odisha, that is 65, and Chhattisgarh, maybe it is 110 rupees, and Bihar 120 rupees. If in farm getting 1 kilo of fungus, so it is hardly we required, hardly it is required, and the investment is around 60 rupees or 55 rupees. So 10 rupees profit will not sustain certain part. Again, we require the diversifications. Again, we require not of a some, we have some large circular cages where carbs can be introduced certain parts to get the profit. So these are the some of the aspects that should be for inland fisheries development that should be looked into so that we can have a good sustainable manners. And again, looking into the people are talking today, tilapia, monosex tilapia, other things, all these things. But you see, we have failed many things for the introduction of that exotics long back. It is going to different systems when we are using in the pond culture. We should be more cautious for the monosex tilapia, other things, because the monosex what we are getting, it is not a 100%. Again, if introducing monosex tilapia in cages to be looked into seriously, because when it escapes to the natural water bodies, it has a prolific breeding and growth. So we again, we have to see for introduction of exotics, other things, we should be more cautious for the introduction in this, the large water bodies. And second thing, again, if the most of the system we are going, the cage culture project that is initiated long back under MMPS program, to look into the livelihood security only. Today, if you want to get this, if you should have PPP more, maybe a large sector companies in certain pets being brought into thick to make this cage culture viable. And it may be there is two parallel systems, because if a 10,000 hectare of reservoir, 0.1% comes into the picture, so a huge area is there. So it may be some if you are going for livelihood for the cooperative societies, other things, we can give something for them and something for the large-scale industrial development in a thing of a value chain, whether you can establish like filleting. We import lot of fillets, basa. If you see any part of the hotel you go, today you are finding the basa. Maybe it's a flat cost 300, 400 in this. But if you're getting selling a 1 kilo of pangasius is only hardly 100 rupees, 110 rupees. Again, developing a filleting market to the country and needing in this. So we require again a value chain and market link so that we can address and have a more price. Again, if you look into, again, if you want again to bring the Monosex is RGCI is working, if we'll have a better sense and shuttle parts for export industry, we should have a strategic biosecurity measures not to escape into the inland water bodies. And because we have seen in Gandhi Sagar or Halali Reserve in Madhya Pradesh, the tilapia's population is eradicated totally, the katla, which is a native and prize fish also. So this is a shifting of the ecology and habitat, and the fisheries are established in the most of the reservoirs for which we are now paying for that. Maybe after a few years, if you run behind all the exotics, you may be see that the inland means maybe 50 to 70%, it is the dominated by the some of the exotic species. So these are the some of, if you look into these things, so we should have a, because everywhere maybe the policy maker, everything changes from time to time. And with that, the system and the facility that should be developed, and it should be effectively utilized, monitored for imposing on certain things where we should not be come out something that which is not detrimental to us for the development of the fisheries sector. Again, if you look, these are the large fish. If you see some fish has the nutritive values, we do not know what the fish is nutritional index, how it is quality it goes to. So with the ICR Institute have brought out 100 fish of the nutritive values, and it has been there. So even small fish like Amblyopharid and Mola, if you'll see, it is a nutritious fish, rich in vitamin A, D, E, K, micronutrients besides protein rich. So if somewhere we can multiply and give the food habit of the Indians, and that will cater. And the, even if the health index, we have tried the experiment in the Sundarban areas where we find that the anemic conditions, other things can be reduced in the far movement though they are working in these things. So definitely if you look into this, like again it is also rich in iodine. Again, if you goiter, other things today is a problem. If you address, even if the how much this fish can be taken by a person in a daily or monthly basis, that can reduce some of these conditions and improve the quality of the health. Today we are concerned about many aspects of the health and quality of fish, and these are the some of the issues. If you look into the three aspects, like carp is the mainstay of Indian aquaculture systems, looking we cannot go for this. Again, medium carp is growing. If you put the medium carp certain part in the sectorial and the state-wise planning, so that you can see the medium carps also. Again, Bengal, if you look into the Bengal, where the people eat means 365 days and 95% of the Bengali eat fish, where these small fish also fetch price. So looking into the region and sector, and again if you look into the Northeast, Pengwa is a fish is coming, knocking, and breeding protocol is standardized. If you can promote again this Pengwa in Northeast, so it again it will grow. Again, morally if you promote in the maybe Telangana, Andhra Pradesh, so it is a good month. If you establish these selective states and these are the focused hatchery, then we have a huge opportunity to multiply and get the price. And besides, if you see, today we are talking of the climate change. So it again is a major concern to us. Today, if we are talking of the climate change, there are climate resilience species. Again, delayed in monsoon, early monsoon. So some fish do not breed. So accordingly, we should see if the katla this year do not breed, what is our alternative? What is our alternative? With the monsoon is...
So thus, I would request to do, request you to please summarize.
Erratic monsoon, so katla do not breed also. So then where we stand? Again, we have to preparedness. If katla do not breed in a polyculture systems, what will be our alternative fish that can be farmers grow?
Dr. Das, can you summarize now?
Many states are taking up the early breeding program also. Early breeding program is a definite a good indicators, like the Chinese and bond breedings in Bankura district of West Bengal, that precure to the early breeding. Again, we see some of this because alkalinity is a major limiting factor during breeding. If any set of the pockets that will be marked for the early breeding program where spawn will be distributed, then what will be the conditions of the different nurseries? There should be spell out and specific guidelines. Again, one of the things we should have a, if you
Dr. Das,
diversified species, what
Dr. Das, are you able to and hear Dr. Das?
Which state, what should be taken? That should be particular human resource and in the existing hatcheries.
I think yes.
Capacity should be built up and gradually it can be spread to other things. Instead of establishing somewhere suddenly a new hatcheries and doing something less in that, but existing hatcheries where the things are going on. So we should build up those capacity and start those activities and propagate. Then we can go. Again, if we'll see the CIFA is a strength like for inland fish production, Jayanti Rohu. Jayanti Rohu inland fish production. So we should see how this Jayanti Rohu can be propagated to the all this across the India so that we can replace, because all of us know this is a 17% realized gain per generation. They have gone up to 12th generations. That is the things. Again, if the inland fish sector, if we'll see, like we have a Banami J strength or Monodon, other thing for brackwater aquaculture, indicus. Inland sector, if we'll see freshwater from like Macrobacterium Rosenbergi and Macrobacterium Malcolmsoni. These are the two candidate species which has a high growth potentials, which needs to be a proper attention, mainly in aquacultures and somewhere we can take out. So that these things will be good for the coming
Dr. Das, so Dr. Das.
Looking into the sector, we can work.
Hello.
Find out. Okay. Thank you. Thank
you. Thank you.
Vibha,
kindly take up. Vibha.
To unmute myself.
Oh, big problem. Ravi, I would request the Joint Secretary. Yeah, are you able to take up?
Hello, can you hear me? Good morning, everybody. Good morning to all of my co-panelists and especially to the hosts and Madam Vibha for having me there. See, it's very interesting to discuss with all of you regarding our latest developments in the fisheries sector at our end. As all of you know that Blue Revolution was just concluded in March 2020. That was a scheme for 5 years with an investment of almost 3,000 crore. And to take the achievements forward and to consolidate the achievements of Blue Revolution, now we have launched a scheme named Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana with an outlay of 20,050 crore for next 5 years. Under the scheme, we envisages that the total production from 37 lakh ton to be taken to 220 lakh ton in next 5 years. And the interestingly, as the speaker before me told you, that almost 70% of the production comes from inland. Similarly, in the next 5 years also, we are going to have the 70% of the share of production from inland only. Rather, we are planning to scale it up to 78%. So in this background, you can appreciate the importance of inland fisheries. And for that way, on freshwater aquaculture, brackish water aquaculture, saline aquaculture, reservoir, wetland, cold water fisheries, rivers and canals, they have a very important role to play. And recognizing the fact that it would be really important to take all the stakeholders on board in the new scheme, we have been looking for active involvement of all the state stakeholders, private individual entrepreneurs also, including beneficiaries. So in the scheme, the participation of private sector on PPP mode, joint venture mode would be highly appreciated if they come forward. In under PMMSY, we envisages that we should see presently the handicaps with our sector are we are having very low productivity if we go by the international standards. Presently, it is around 3 tons per hectare, which we want to take to 5 tons per hectare at the end of 2025 March. Similarly, we want that we should generate at least 55 lakh job opportunities, and this post-harvest losses should be reduced to 10%. And we are also looking for, in a big way, to double our fisheries exports and take it to 1 lakh crore by 2025. So, targeting that that in a big way, we have to focus on inland fisheries. We recognize that availability of seed and food is a big problem. Cold chain infrastructure is a big problem. Regulatory framework and at ground level, laboratory network, aquatic health services is also a problem. So in the PMMSY, the key strategies are availability of quality brood and seed by having a national network of brood banks and hatcheries, growth clusters, area-wise, species-wise. We are going to have 6 aqua parks with specific theme, like one for shrimps, another for ornamental fisheries, cold water fisheries, like that. Then we need to have strong institutional framework at district level, sub-district level, state level. Then we want that there should be a special focus on Northeast also, Himalayan states also, and aspirational districts also. We are looking for encouraging private sector participation, entrepreneurship models, and PPP models in a big way under PMMSY. And the another thing which can add to the bargaining power of our fish farmers and fishers is that we want to, through the collectivization of fishers and fish farmers, we want to promote 500 FFPOs also. The speaker before me told that species diversification and self-reliance in, shrimp brood stock is another area where we are looking for in a big way. When it comes to specific activities, in inland fisheries and aquaculture, we are going to invest more than 3,500 crore of rupees. For technology infusion like RAS, Biofloc also, we are looking for more than 500 crore investment. Similarly, ornamental fisheries. And we have, this scheme is different in a way from Blue Revolution. Earlier, we used to allocate in lump sum. This time, what we have done, we have made allocation activity-wise along with the physical targets to be attained in a particular year. Year-wise, we have fixed the targets. So, if we look at the quality affordable brood and seed, we are looking for nucleus breeding center, brood bank, hatcheries, rearing ponds, nurseries, aquatic facilities, quarantine facilities, laboratory network, disease monitoring, and the traceability in standards and certification, accreditation of hatcheries, import of germplasm, and when it comes to diversification, apart from our IFC, we are looking also for fungaceous tilapia, scampies, sea bass, mud crab, shrimp. These are the species, and the strategy which we are going for is that there would be a mission fingerling, and there would be specific focus on the diversification, species diversification, and the convergence is also one of our trump in this area, that we need to have convergence with NREGA ponds, RKVY, other schemes of the line departments. Then if we talk about reservoirs are for sleeping giants. We are looking for another 10 lakh tons of additional fish production from our reservoirs. And for that, we have kept a provision for investment of 520 crore, and we want to generate 10 lakh direct and indirect employment opportunities. And we are looking for integrated development of reservoirs by setting up of in-situ hatcheries, landings, centers will be given, seed rearing areas would be there, facilities would be provided, boats would be provided, cold chain facilities would be provided for all the reservoirs which we are going to identify in association with the states. And we have been talking to the states from the day of approval of the scheme, that they should prepare their approaches for the development, and they should prepare for the state fisheries development plan by building it from the sub-district level and district level. Because cage culture is going to be in reservoir, is going to be our big bet. We want that 5% of the reservoir should be earmarked for cage culture. And we are also in the process of preparing a model leasing policy so that it facilitates across the states in the reservoirs to have a smooth laying of cage cultivation. And apart from that, we are also in the process of developing entrepreneurship models for promoting cage cultivation in reservoirs in a big way. And we are looking for reservoirs, 2 lakh ton fish production per year. This would be under our assistance. Apart from this, we are also looking for 6 to 7 lakh ton production per year by the private sector as well. There is another area that is saline and alkaline area. There are almost land measuring 2 lakh hectare available in Haryana, Punjab, Rajasthan, and Western UP. The salinity in these lands is so high that they are not fit for any crop or cultivation. Only shrimp cultivation is possible in these areas. So we will be converting these waste land into wealth lands under PMMSY with an envisaged investment of 526 crore, which is going to generate 1 lakh employment opportunities. And we are looking for promoting an aqua park, as our honorable minister said the other day, that we are going to make North India as a hub of fisheries exports. Because I am told the other day in a meeting that state government of UP has already prepared a cluster approach for development of saline fisheries in western Uttar Pradesh around Mathura and Agra. Haryana is also on board with us. Punjab is also, we are talking to Punjab for development of these areas. And we are looking for developing these area as a one-stop solution, like we'll be putting there all kinds of seed, feed, laboratory network, integrated cold storage, FFPO, marketing, buyback facility. This all we are going to put under PMMSY, and it is going to be a kind of silent aqua revolution for these areas. And in this all entire effort, we will be looking for close association with ICR Institute, especially Central Institute of Fisheries Education, the regional office, which is located in Rohtak. And one area, another important area is cold water fisheries. For development of our Himalayan areas, our hilly areas, our difficult areas, we want to promote cold water fisheries under PMMSY with an envisaged investment of more than 330 crore of rupees. And in these areas, we are looking for setting up of trout hatcheries, raceway along inputs and new ponds in Himalayan region. We want to set up cage culture also in the cold water reservoirs. And we are looking for RAS for cold water fisheries also. And if need be, we are already up with the idea that we will promote these states if they want to import the superior germplasm from other countries for their trout fisheries. We will support that. And basically, what would be the outcome is like this: there will be infrastructure creation. They will be utilizing their existing resources. It will lead to employment of generation also. It will add to the farmer's income, and it will lead to creation of post-harvest infrastructure. And it will definitely promote production and productivity is in these areas. And we are already in discussion with state governments. Arunachal is already up on board with us, and J&K, Ladakh also. We are in constant touch with them. And so far as trout is concerned, we are very much interested in brand promotion, because it is a kind of fish which can be in a big way called organic trout. If you ever see their farming and aquaculture, it is totally done with the help of no additive which can be called chemical. So we can brand it in a big way. Apart from this PMMSY, we are also looking in a big way for technology infusion. more crop per drop. And for especially for promotion of technology, we have earmarked 1236 crore of rupees, under which we are going to support this RAS, bioflock, aquaponics, high density pond aquaculture, integrated multi-trophic aquaculture, and pen culture. So this way we will be promoting quality, disease-free environment. This can be taken up all around the season with high productivity and best higher price realization, giving more and more remunerative prices and profit to the farmers, which can be taken in semi-urban areas also. Along with this, we are preparing this area-specific interventions also, which will be doing in Northeast and aspirational districts and Himalayan area also. And the very important component, if we come to the entrepreneurial model, is ornamental fisheries. We have earmarked an investment of rupees more than 570 crore for ornamental fisheries. We look at like this, that the current market for ornamental fisheries in India is for 500 crore only. We, in next 5 years, we want to take this market to 1500 crore of rupees, and we want that presently we are insignificant player in the international trade in ornamental fisheries. With this investment and by promoting entrepreneurial models in fabrication of aquarium, and then setting up a brood bank, rearing unit, hatcheries, infrastructure and marketing, we are looking for creating almost 10 lakh of employment in the next 5 years in this ornamental fisheries subsector. Apart from this, as I told you in the beginning, that we are targeting 6 aqua parks, integrated aqua parks, which would be kind of one-stop integrated park for entire fisheries value chain, for rapid expansion of fisheries and aquaculture, especially Northeast and other states. And the specific theme would be shrimp park in North India, then ornamental park, then Northeast tilapia park, Pangasius park, multi-purpose park. And these parks will have all the facilities from nursery, hatcheries, processing, cold chain, everything would be there. Feed, seed, everything would be available inside these parks. And we are quite thinking of promoting entrepreneurial models in different subsectors, because with these models, we want that income generation activities with individuals also are taken up, and they would be provided connectivity like fisher and aqua farmer. We will be connecting him to processor, exporter, with buyback arrangement for his quality inputs, and he can tie up with MPDA also, and he will be provided from our side support services like linkages with producers, bankable projects, e-marketing, registration, certification, labeling and clearances, etc. would be closely provided support from the government side. Apart from this, creation of integrated cold storage come retail chain infrastructure is also envisaged for processing plant, urban cold storage, urban retail market, urban food kiosks. These are all activities which we are going to support. And the one of the important component under the scheme is that we are looking in a big way to escalate, to double our exports from present level of around 47,000 crore to 1 lakh crore in next 5 years. For that, we will be working in close association with MPDA. And for that, we are looking for deepening of existing export markets, collectivization, aqua parks, FFPOs. We will try to overcome the non-tariff barriers, phytosanitary measures, and specific species diversification is one of the prominent strategy. Apart from shrimp, we are looking for tilapia, scampi, mud crab, and pangasius also. we want to grow horizontally and vertically in area expansion. Brackish water and saline areas, we are looking in a big way. Technology infusion, I have already discussed. So this is how we want to look at the export front also. Apart from this, the department is operating one more scheme, that is Fisheries Infrastructure Development Scheme, with an purpose of 7,522 crore. So far, we can see that most of the projects are coming from coastal states. Northern states are not coming in a big way. I will request through this platform that states which are having a good, potential of inland fisheries, because this scheme covers all the activities pertaining to reservoir, alkaline, saline areas, wetlands, freshwater aquaculture. Even private individuals, private companies also can avail this facility of interest subvention under FIDF. We have approved few private projects also. Day before, we have approved a project of individual private entrepreneur from J&K with an investment of more than 55 crore of rupees. I was very happy to look at it, that he is putting a self-contained unit for trout production with processing and all hatcheries and nursery and everything. So I will request states and other private entrepreneurs who have access to listen to me, that please prepare good projects in a big way, looking for creation of employment and adding to the production and productivity with quality. So this is so far under FIDF, we already have approved the projects worth more than 2000 crore. So there is another scope for approving projects worth more than 4000 crore. So I will request the states present, the stakeholders present, to prepare their projects. Since here we are discussing inland fishery, so inland fisheries, reservoir cage culture, alkaline saline water, cold water fisheries, developing of hatcheries, any project which you feel, seed plant, feed plant, cold storage, ice plant, which you think is the demand of the, any bankable project, we will be happy to support. If you want to know more about the scheme, the entire brochure, all with guidelines, unit cost, is available on our website. And again, before I conclude, I would like to reiterate that under PMMSY, we are going to pump in from the government side almost 10,000 crore of an investment, which is three times the investment which was made under Blue Revolution. So each and every component is going to be an important factor in meeting the target of 220 lakh ton of fish production by March 2025. And this today's discussion is in a way is very important for me, because I look after the inland fisheries, and in the total production envisaged of 220 ton lakh ton, the share almost of 78%, that is 171 lakh ton, is supposed to coming from inland fisheries. So freshwater aquaculture, brackish water aquaculture, reservoir, wetland, cold water fisheries, the handicaps which we have in the gap which we have been experiencing through PMMSY, we have tried to address these gaps, and through different strategies, we are working on different missions to take the targets forward, so that each and every component taken to the optimum output and outcome. And now the best part, as I told earlier, I will repeat at the in the PMMSY, every activity component has been given a specific target along with the financial allocation. So that way, inland fisheries become very important in meeting the target of 220 lakh ton by March 2025. Apart from this, the other thing is that we are going to invest out of this total investment of 20,050 crore, 11,000 crore is the direct beneficiary oriented activities. Whereas in the infrastructure, we are going to invest 9,000 crore. So from that scale, you can imagine that the investment which we are going to make in infrastructure as well as the beneficiary oriented activities. I hope with this sort of approach and investment, definitely we'll be able to address the constraints and the challenges before us. And I am hopeful that we'll be able to meet the target of 220 lakh ton comfortably and achieve the target of our doubling fisheries exports also. And in these targets, I'm quite hopeful that we'll overcome the present ongoing crisis, and inland fisheries will come up to the expectations of all the stakeholders and make its best contribution. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, sir, for sharing your views and the initiatives and efforts taken by your department. And I'm sure with all the economical packages that have been given to this sector, people will avail these and will make India's blue economy net get more bigger than what it is right now. So as we all know, country ranks third in fisheries and second in aquaculture. And able to achieve our target, and we'll be able to help all the people who are involved in this particular sector. Well, thank you very much for sharing your views.
Thank you.
I would now like to request Dr. Ravi Shankar. Sir, as you represent CIFT, would you like to highlight issues and measures to address in the field of harvest and post-harvest, since you have a great experience in this particular sector?
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, good afternoon to everybody. Most respected Sagar Mehraji and my friend Dr. Das, and of course my senior and my guru, my Isab. First of all, thanks to Mr. Raviji and Bhatiaji for inviting CIFT to be part of this very important webinar, because we have been taking part in many webinars, but I think talking on inland fisheries is, I think, it is the most important. I think I am sure all of you will agree with the, you know, the impetus with the government is giving and what Mehraji told about the so many schemes. I think if you are I must thank Dr. Das for highlighting a lot of issues regarding the aquaculture, inland aquaculture. So taking cue from that, many of the problems and challenges which I was planning to discuss, if you have heard Mehraji, I think most of the things are all covered somewhere or other. Only thing now that has to be implemented, of course, as Joint Secretary Saab said, the cooperation of everybody is required. Otherwise, we will not be heading anywhere. The schemes will remain on the paper. So I'm sure all the schemes and measures which the government is taking, we must take use of that and work complementing each other. You know, because there are a lot of departments, there are research departments, there are developmental agencies, the State Department. I think everybody should work together so that we realize the importance of this. I'm sure all of you must have heard the recent announcement of the SOFIA statistics. Few days back, they were announcing. Everything is increasing, especially in the inland sector. The consumption is increasing, the production is increasing. So being representing the CIFT on harvest and post-harvest, for me, equally important is harvest and post-harvest. Okay, because we may increase the production, but unfortunately, the harvesting techniques still are very, very primitive. If you see in the many reservoirs, we are not able to catch. We are not employing a proper gear and a proper craft. If you're talking of craft, still we are using the primitive old wooden, crafts. We need to upgrade them. Okay. I think CIFT has been, working on this area in introducing fuel efficient vessel designs. So, wood is very expensive. So we have introduced, alternate wood materials like rubber wood, coconut wood, FRP canoes. And now we have recently launched solar powered boats. you know, which are ideal for inland fisheries. You are talking of reservoir or any other inland water body. I think introducing the solar powered boats would be most ideal. We have already introduced two models in Kerala. I think we are also talking in Jharkhand now. So we should be introducing them so that we have a less pollution, no pollution at all. When you are having a solar boat, obviously no pollution. So environmental friendly, energy efficient, I think that is the one thing we must be looking at. If you're talking of the gears, you know, still we are using the very, very primitive gears. It's not optimized properly. We did some work with Himachal Pradesh. You know what's happening? People are simply using some gear. What's happening? They're getting entangled into the, you know, submerged tree trunks, and they remain there, and they're causing two problems. One is environmental problem because they're all synthetic materials, and the ghost fishing, that is another major concern for us. So we need to optimize a proper craft and the gear for these inland water bodies. And when we are, you know, by releasing seeds, we are increasing the production. And again, sustainability, conservation are also very, very important. We should not be indiscriminately exploiting. I know in inland water bodies, still there are destructive fishing techniques are used, dynamites are used. I think they have to be, you know, phased out. So we should be looking at optimizing the fishing gear, a good, you know, eco-friendly, like, you know, energy efficient fishing crafts. That's very, very important. And CAFT will be very, very happy to handhold with any state department in future for introducing them. We need to optimize the proper, you know, fishing system. Then coming to the, you know, the post-harvest sector, I think many, many, you know, things were addressed. Dr. Das was highlighting the importance of fish, you know, into the nutrition. And the CAFT in association with CIFA and the CIFRI, we have taken up a work with World Fish in doing intervention study, because fish is highly nutritious, you know. With this increasing production in aquaculture, definitely we can address the issue of nutritional security, food security. And when the demand is increasing, you know, people are looking at ready to eat, ready to cook, ready to serve sort of a products. People have no time to bring fish, cut it and ready for the table. So we should be looking at value adding to the whatever increased production. But one thing again, like fishing technique in the post-harvest sector also, not all fishes are amenable for processing. Okay. If you take, for example, of some of the inland species, the main problem people face is the fin bones. Okay. Especially the fishes like silver carp. They are not, you know, very difficult to, you know, have for the processing technology, like making it to fillet or steaks. Lot of pin bones. Only people who are used to the eating freshwater fish are knowing about this. Whereas if you give the freshwater fish to the people in the coastal region, they are not liking it, even though there is highly nutritious, because of the bones and also the muddy flavor. Okay, there are technologies to, you know, address this issue. So I think those things have to be implemented. And the quality and the safety is another major concern. I am sure all of you will be aware. A recent problem of formaldehyde, you know, using of ammonia when fish is being transported to the interior places. And that was again addressed, you know, we developed a immediate rapid technique to identify and if there is any contamination or by formaldehyde, the technique is already available. I think we should bring awareness to the people about the safety of fish. The quality and safety is very, very important. We need to improve the cold chain facility. Right now, the infrastructure, what's happening is in marine, already the, you know, the whole system is established. But in freshwater, in inland fisheries, still we have a long way to go. I think I'm sure the schemes announced by the Joint Secretary Saab will help in establishing all this. With the, you know, help of the institutions, definitely we have a long way to go. And when I'm talking of, you know, I think my friend Das was telling about the pangasius. There's always a talk that, you know, we are talking of Vietnam Basa and comparing Indian Basa. We are talking of quality, the color. You know, I think somewhere we need to improve the farm, you know, practices. Okay. Definitely our Indian Basa is definitely superior or equally superior than any other Basa. Only thing, we are not able to manage the water quality, you know, address the issue of the feed, which we are giving. I think once we do all this, definitely we'll be able to cater the high quality product to the consumers. And we need to, when I'm talking of value addition, making it ready for the table, whether it is in the ready to cook farm, ready to eat farm or ready to fry, we need to cater, you know, identify the market. We need to identify who are your target consumers. Accordingly, we need to develop a product, whether it is in chilled form, frozen form, ready to serve form, or it can be in a form of an extruded product snack. It can be many, many products can be done. And another thing which we are undermining, we are not using, is the waste, you know, the rest raw materials. You talk from the freshwater fish, the scales, the skin, the head, you know, huge potential. there are a lot of nutraceutical products, industrial pharma products can be produced. You know, you talk of collagen, gelatin, you know, the from the even the shell waste, you can talk of chitin, chitosan, hydroxyapatite, a lot of periodontal applications, a lot of applications in the, you know, sutures. So many things can be done from the intestine, the sutures, you know, the surgical gauze, you know, the wound healing properties. There are plenty of properties from the rest raw materials. When I say rest raw material, I think we should not be calling it as a waste. We are actually not respecting the rest raw materials. I think we should. There are a lot of technologies. We must use the whole fish as such. The complete utilization of the harvested catch is very, very important. So we need to improve the value chain. We need to address to the different population. And we also need to improve the hygienic condition. Because if you see the markets, one problem in the inland sector is, you know, all the scattered the landing centers. Because there's no proper facility. If I am talking of valuing, adding value to the waste, the collection is not there. You know, the waste cannot be collected because the that has to be improved. And we should treat also equally as we are treating the fillet or a steak. So that is what is important. We need to improve the marketing facility. We need to brand them. We need to label our product. Okay, we need to place us in, you know, I think a lot of now the fish consumption we have to increase. I think again, I was talking somewhere else also. Transportation and live fish, you know, live fish transportation is another area we must strengthen. We don't have a proper system now. We need to improve that system. If a live fish is available to the consumer, it will definitely add value to the, you know, the person who is growing, the farmer. Okay. Because then there is no question of apprehensions of the quality or safety of the fish because it is available fresh, live in, you know, many other countries are catching up this. So we must, I think, divert our attention to live fish. And machinery is another area. You know, we need to develop low cost machinery, cost effective machinery, which are suitable for us. We can't depend on imported machinery, which are very, very expensive. So we want to promote fish processing as an enterprise. We need to have all this cold chain facility, you know, the infrastructure, the low cost processing machinery, and, you know, interventions like drying, improving drying, smoking, you know, the cured products. There's plenty of demand, I'm telling you, in the country. Domestic market is definitely, of course, Maharaji was talking about the improving the export. If you see the contribution of freshwater fish in export is very, very limited, except to the shrimp. I think we need to, you know, upgrade our fish species into the export market, whether it is Rohu, Tilapia. I think that's where we have to give a lot of, and, you know, CAFT has established 4 processing units in Himachal. So I think that we should, you know, replicate in other states. I think 4, you know, in we have already done in Gobind Sagar, Pong, Solan, and one more reservoir. So we have put up a small processing unit for the freshwater fish, which is grown in, I think that was again a collaboration with SIFRI. So I would like to compliment my friend's work in SIFRI. So I think we should work together. And again, Sagar Maharaj has developed the cold water fisheries. You know, we are in talking to Himachal now. In Patli Kuhal, we are planning to establish a canning plant, you know, smoked trout. It has got a huge potential. So somewhere, I think we did some intervention in, you know, improving the chilled facility. I think trout, the cold water fisheries, whether it is in Jammu and Kashmir or in Himachal, we are also working with DCFR. My friend, Dr. Debojit is also joined in this webinar. We all can join together with the State Department and the Department of Fisheries, Government of India. I think there are a lot of technologies available, whether it is for the harvesting in terms of the gear or the craft. We need to optimize them and we need to improve all this facility. There are a lot of technology for value addition, simple interventions in processing so that more hygienic, quality fish, safe food is available, fish is available to the consumers. So CAFT will be very willing to join hands with everybody. So there are a lot of technology available. Only thing we need to take it to the field. So thank you for this opportunity. And anybody interested, they can always be in touch with us so that we are willing to work. And again, I would like to mention about Mahesh Ji. We are already working in Nandarbar and all that, you know, some of the interventions my Bombay Center is already doing with them. We would like to strengthen all that. So CAFT will be very happy to join hands with any of the developmental agency, academia, and other departments to take this technology to the people. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for sharing such, you know, useful insights with all of us. So like you said, we also have Dr. Debojit with us. So Dr. Debojit, he was talking about cold water fish farming also. So what are the prospects and potentials according to you is for cold water fish farming in India?
Is it audible, madam? Is it audible?
Yes, sir, it is. Yes, sir. but okay. We can't see you.
Very good afternoon, the respected Sagar Mehraji and Vibha Madam. Thank you for giving an opportunity DCFR to participate and share the views regarding prospects and opportunities of cold water fisheries in India. If you see, the Indian Himalayan region has a very unique ecosystem and very fragile ecosystem. Although in terms of production, the contribution from cold water sector to the inland sector is very, very small amount, but the diversity of and the value of the fish available in cold water sector is very high. In brief, I can tell you, in inland open water cold water fisheries, if you talk about cold water fisheries, rivers and lakes and reservoirs, which is the most valuable fish in terms of conservation point of view or in terms of ecotourism of point of view. So if you talk about cold water fisheries, it has two or three different prospects. First prospects may be definitely aquaculture related to the livelihood security. And another aspect is the biodiversity conservation, and third aspect may be the ecotourism. The fish can be linked to the ecotourism, and that also has a different prospects, which can also improve the livelihood security of the people who are residing in the hilly population. And if you talk about production, which is the main context of this today's webinar, if we talk about the production, the main production comes from the one of the most significant and important fish, that is rainbow trout. If you see production of cold water fishes, we have got high altitudinal areas, we have got mid altitudinal areas, also low areas. So if you concentrate on high areas, which is the favorable agroclimatic condition for development of cold water species, particularly the rainbow trout, our current level of production may not be very very impressive, because our present production is only 1,000 ton at this moment, including all our leading state like Jammu Kashmir, Himachal Pradesh, Sikkim, and also Arunachal, and Uttarakhand also has started the rainbow production. But it is a very small amount, small contribution. 1,000 ton may not be a very significant one, but we have got a lot of potential in that. I want to highlight only now at present the ratios we are utilizing in aquaculture, that is utilized up to 50%. Our production potential per ratios is now only 500 to 700 kg. So that can be, with the intervention of technological upgradation or best management practice, that can be definitely 1,000 kg per ratios, 1 ton per ratios. So if we have intervention or best management practice of our cold water sector, we can increase the production from 1,000 to 2,000. So it is one of the important approach. So that can be easily achievable. And if you have to achieve the target of the five times higher, if you think a projection figure of 1,000 tons, definitely we need to have an infrastructure development. Infrastructure in terms of raceways, infrastructure development in terms of feed mills, infrastructure development in terms of hatcheries also. So if you have an infrastructure development in terms of raceways, that has to be at least 5,000 to 6,000 numbers of raceways has to be built for cold water sectors, and vis-a-vis, which is at present is around 1,000 to 2,000 numbers of raceways presently in functional. So if you have a projection figure of 10,000 ton, which is achievable in 5 years of period of time in case of rainbow trout production, then again we have to have a number of infrastructure development has to be around 10,000 to 12,000. So that is one of the thing where we need to give emphasis, the infrastructure development along the technological intervention, which we can achieve easily 5,000 tons, which is achievable target, and also we can project a figure of 10,000 tons within a period of 5 years. So there we have calculated, if you have to have a figure of 5,000 tons and 10,000 tons, the number of answer has to be around 50 to 75 first instant, and then maybe 100 to 200, 120 numbers in terms of second instant. And the water use, because all, you know, trout aquaculture is mostly dependent on the water, natural water, spring water, basically, which is favorably, you know, trout aquaculture. And per 600 liter per hour of water flow is required for, you know, production of 25 kg in per meter cube of, you know, raceways. So that is one of the important things that we have to count. So if you have to produce 10,000 ton of, you know, rainbow trout within a period of 5 years, then our total, you know, water availability will be around 3,000 to 4,000 million liters. I think that is available at our, you know, in our natural water bodies high, because we have got very fast flowing, you know, high altitudinal rivers, which are perennial. So that much of water will be available. So we can have a projection figure of 10,000 tons if we can, you know, develop the infrastructure, if we achieve, have the technological interventions, if we build up the hatcheries, and if we train the, you know, government officer farmers to have a production of, you know, 1 ton, you know, rainbow trout per raceways, which is around 30 meters square raceways. I would like to highlight one point. Another important constraint in trout farming, not developing trout farming in India, may be the, you know, requirement of feed. Whatever feed produced by the states, their FCR is around 1.5 to around, you know, 1.7. But in a world standard, it is around, you know, once, if you see the world scenario comparative, it is around 1.2. So recently we have worked out and we have developed a feed which FCR comes around 0.921. And that we have, you know, commercially tie up with a company like Gruel Private Limited. And now feeds are available in the, you know, with us. So if we can, you know, intervene with this, you know, advanced feed, having, you know, higher feed efficiency, having better, you know, feed conversion, having better digestibility, also the pellet size and, you know, structure of the feed. If we see all this context, if we can, you know, feed with the present feed developed by DCFR and tying up with the industry, I think we can also improve the total feed production, particularly rainbow trout production in the country to a tune of 10,000 ton within a span of, you know, 5 years. 5,000 ton is achievable. 10,000 ton is also, I think, possible to achieve within a span of, you know, 5 years of time. Now, one more important thing is the, you know, raceways. If we have to really have a jump of rainbow trout production from the tune of 10,000 to 20,000 ton, or maybe, you know, 30,000 ton, more intervention has to come from the recirculatory aquaculture system. Because our raceways, whatever we are doing in the Indian context, either in Jammu Kashmir or either in Himachal Pradesh, our production capacity is only 20 to, you know, 30 tons per raceways, which is not possible. 30 tons yet is not possible. At present, Himachal Pradesh and Jammu Kashmir, they are producing around 20 tons per meter cube. You know, 20 kg per meter cube. 20 kg per meter cube they are producing. Now, if we have a raceways in cold water aquaculture or trout production, then it is achievable to produce 50 kg per meter cube. So, which is almost, you know, double the figure. So, that has, you know, approach, you know, in developing the raceway culture, RAS system for cold water aquaculture, particularly for the rainbow trout farming in the state. And DCFR has been working. And DCFR has been working on two models. One model is a small economically viable model, which is engineering validated and also efficient, cost efficient, where we are giving a target of 250 kg of rainbow trout. Within 250 kg of rainbow trout, in a, you know, within a, you know, we having, you know, economically viable and within a small scale area, so that we also replicated, you know, many times in the different places like Jammu Kashmir and Himachal Pradesh. Another, you know, rainbow trout area system we are developing, that is having a capacity of 1 ton production, and that is 1 ton production capacity. And that will take 1 or 2 years of time for, you know, multiplication into the farming system. But one system is ready, which is, you know, 250 kg per, you know, per RAS system. And that is engineering validated and also cost effective, efficient model. And a farmer can easily adopt. And so that model can be, you know, replicated to the farming system if we have to have further increase of rainbow trout production in the country. So that should be the approach, and I think we can discuss further in the different level in the government level also. And if you have to work out little detail about it, I mean, how many hatcheries, how many millions of seed is required, you know, how much fish meal is required, and what should be the phosphorus discharge part of fish production to our, you know, natural water base, that has to be also calculated to have a, you know, sustainable production of, you know, rainbow trout in our country. And one last aspect I would like to highlight, which Sagar Mehra sir has told, you know, import of improved strain of rainbow trout in the country. And with the permission of, you know, government, already, you know, 3 states has already imported improved strain of rainbow trout in the country. Himachal has already imported. Jammu Kashmir has already imported. Also, Uttarakhand also already imported. So we are looking for the study. We are doing the study of whether this imported strain are having better growth, are they sterile, are they triploid. We are looking at monitoringly, you know, intensively. We are looking into it. We are maintaining the comparative growth of the fishes, and we will give a detailed study on it, whether this imported strain are really having a better growth compared to our existing strain which has been imported to the country long back. So this detail has to be worked out. I thank you very much. I thank you, organizer, for giving us an opportunity to share our views in front of all audience and the government.
Thank you, sir, for sharing such detailed information with our participants. Now I would like to request Mr. Mahesh Deore. He's a joint commissioner, Government of Maharashtra. So, sir, since you represent Maharashtra state, so what are the steps or initiatives taken by your department to make fisheries the best remunerative and excellent source of income for farmers? So would you like to throw some light on the same?
Good morning, Honorable Mehra sir, Das sir, Honorable host and participants. Sir, all of us know Corona taught us two importance of the two things. First is safety and second one is food. Government of Maharashtra as well as Fisheries Department contributing part of the proteinaceous food. The subject regarding the challenge and opportunities in the fisheries sector, I would like to present here. First is that the challenge of underdeveloped marketing channel is come up during the lockdown period. Sir, here the impact of COVID-19, the distance market and transportation facilities has severely affected on the fisheries sector, but immediately the opportunity of the domestic market come up. So I like to present the good example of the development of the domestic market in Maharashtra. The Blue Revolution scheme given catch culture project in Mulanagar Reservoir. We have 106 beneficiaries doing the catch culture project in Mulanagar Reservoir, established 2,120 cages and taking the production. The expected production is 4,240 metric ton is expected, but they tossed the opportunity of the lockdown crisis. The opportunity is that they develop the domestic market from the Mulanagar till Ahmednagar district in Maharashtra. Here, they are selling the live fish few days of the lockdown, initial lockdown of the few days. Fishing is not permitted, but afterwards government giving the permission for the fishing. So during the permission, they are selling the live fishes on the highway side, roadside marketing shops. Almost in this difficult period, they sell 42 ton of the live fish and fish at good price during this crisis also. The government of central government as well as Maharashtra government boosting this sector, this fishery sector, with the help of the schemes like e-marketing, refrigerated vehicles, pickup van, insulated vehicles, two wheelers with ice box, three wheeler auto rickshaws with ice box. This we have good opportunity to promote the fisheries business as well as the marketing of the fish products. Government of India recently on 8th June released the notification of constitution of the state level approval and monitoring committee, a scheme bring out the blue revolution through sustainable and responsible development of the fisheries sector in India. The total investment of rupees 20,050 crore for its implementation of the 5-year periods. Means these projects welcoming us the big challenges in the fisheries sector. The first I would like to state, the supply of quality fish seed. In Maharashtra, there are 33 fish rearing hatcheries and 19 rearing centers. Out of 33 fish seed hatcheries, 12 given on lease basis to private and private entrepreneurs. But the demand and supply, there is the variation. The government owns irrigation tanks, almost 2,448 reservoirs, demands 46 crore fingerlings. And the other resources, the total resources require 140 fingerling fish seed in the Maharashtra state. So it's a big opportunity to grab the fish seed market, having high value, efficient requesting the efficient entrepreneurs should come up to establish the fish hatcheries. The seed rearing centers establishment has low investment, high profit and moderate risk. Government assisting for the hatchery is 25 lakhs in the past blue revolution scheme, as well as giving good assistance, as well as additional assistance in Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana too. Then when we are self-reliant in the fish seed, automatically the challenge of the high feed cost comes up. This feed, use of the feed is very important to develop the production as well as the sector. Here the fish cost is somewhat ahead due to the absence of feed mills in the near vicinity, but government giving provision last time, three feed mills in the Maharashtra state sanctioned by the central government through the centrally sponsored scheme of Blue Revolution, that is 2 crores feed mill. Its capacity is 10 ton per day. So we have good scope in this scheme also, as well as small, medium and big feed mill establishment in the state with the help of the central government. Then the big source is the diversification of the high value fishes, fish culture species in the aquaculture, inland aquaculture system. There is a demand. Comparatively, the cost of the pabda, amur carp, koi carp is almost twice than the routine culture species. So it's good scope in this sector also, and government is also promoting, supporting in this sector. Then the inland sector facing the lack of processing and value addition of the inland catch. I would like to present one good example in aspirational district of Nandurbar. We are working with Mr. Murthy, sir from Vashi, SIFT, Mumbai. So here the Nandurbar is the 100% tribal aspirational district. There we gathered the women's group and given training to the training for the value added products. So there is the huge scope in harvesting of the rice fish. They are drying this rice fish and selling. In the routine case, they are getting 110 rupees per kg. But after giving training by the SIFT, they are getting plus 40 rupees for their products. It's a very good opportunity. It should be replicated in all over state is very important. The another scope of the ornamental fish culture in India, consider as the Honorable Mehra sir told, is the sleeping giant in this sector. So India has, I would like to state, India has two biodiversity hotspots, which are northeast eastern region, Western Ghat. There are more 250 indigenous ornamental fish species can introduce as potential export in the foreign export. We can grab it. So is the per capita consumption. Per capita consumption of the India is 9 kg per year. The small countries like Maldives ranked highest in the fish consumption per capita with 166 kg. So here is the big scope, and this is the this is challenge also to convert into the opportunities. Now due to the COVID, the scenario is changed. The China eats more fishes from Myanmar and Vietnam also. So India having good opportunity in this sector also. The ornamental fish, Singapore is the capital of the ornamental fish. It contributes 12.7% of the total export. As I said, we have biodiversity, two hotspots. We can do better in this sector also. The good participants of qualified professional can grab this sector also. Sir, I am bringing in notice of Honorable Mehra sir. Sir, last time in Blue Revolution scheme, we face some scheme head creation problems, but this time I am assured the listeners that government has taken good initiative with PMMSY scheme and rectified issues of Blue Revolution schemes also, requesting to encourage to invest in the inland sector. And last, sir, I would like to state in single sentence, dear past, thank you for the lesson. Dear future, we are ready. Your support is important, Honorable Mehra sir and Das sir and all of you. Yes. By this way, we are fully ready to face the challenge and it converts into the opportunities. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, thank you, sir. Thank you for sharing your insights. As you aptly say, we are future ready. So I'm sure, you know, our participants will also agree with us. So now moving on to Mr. Upare. Mr. Upare, as you have worked with NABARD, you have worked with FAO as a consultant, and you have wealth of experience in working with the World Bank also. So we all have been, you know, facing this unprecedented times this year. The post-lockdown, you know, there has been a reverse migration and there is a huge pressure on rural agri sector. So how inland fisheries can help them, help farmers for their earnings? And now that you've since worked with NABARD, what role do you think NABARD can play in this particular sector for the upliftment of these farmers?
Very thanks, Dr. Moy. And all the panelists are concerned. I am able to hear?
Yes, sir, we can hear you.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that's fine. I am very much thankful for inviting me for this seminar. In fact, when we see the lot of seminars, the fisheries is only one topic they give it and put the workshop. But this whole workshop is only for the fisheries. That shows that the AgroVision is giving the concern and importance to the sector. So I must thankful for the AgroVision for such a initiatives they have taken it.
Thank
you. Now for me is concerned, I worked in a various countries like Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, Vietnam, Bangladesh, Malawi, and so many other countries is concerned. Besides, in India, the many projects has been implemented. Now you have heard the most of the policy makers and all this, but I am actually in the field of project management is concerned. Now in India, we have implemented quite a good number of projects that is called a community tank management project in Orissa, AP, Karnataka, West Bengal, and agriculture competitiveness project. So I will be telling you about a few projects which are successful that will be as a sort of a model which can be developed for that. So one project is the agriculture, Assam Agriculture Competitiveness Project. In that, the fisheries, three components were taken. One is the ponds, because in case of Assam, every farmers, they have some ponds in their land. So these ponds were taken, and these ponds had production of about earlier, before project, is hardly 500 or 400 kilogram per head, which we enhanced to 3,500, 3.5 tons into that. In case of tanks, also it was about 400 before project, so which has been increased to 2.5 tons. So how this has been achieved? That's a question, because our major objective is to enhance the productivity. As Mr. Mehra, he was telling, our emphasis is on enhancing the productivity. So this has been achieved. This has been achieved by stocking the bigger size of fish as a seed, then giving the farmers a training from their extension workers. Normally in a government, now that the staff is less, so they are not able to provide the extension services, but we have provided in a World Bank projects from the NGOs and others, they can give the extension. So that extension has been done. Then there is a thinking that we should give the subsidy. The subsidy is usually given 20%, 10%, 15%. But here, what the concept was to give the complete amount to them, 90% to them, increase, and next year onwards, they themselves from their surplus, they will be doing it. So 90% subsidy was given into that, and they produce it. The third component here is the wheels. What you mean by wheels is that when the river changes the river course of it, it forms a deeper tank and they close into that. So it forms a wheel, a small water body into that. That water body also has been about giving about 300, 400 kilograms per hectare, has been enhanced to 1.6 tons. So this is about 230% increase into that. Besides that, there was integrated farming. You see, when you go to the pond, on the bunds, nothing is there. The bund, the banana was planted, and that is the agro and fisheries integrated farming. Then another farming was pig, paddy cum fish culture. A lot of paddy areas is there. There we have developed it. So this way, round about 72,000 people have been covered into this project. And the very important thing is that by seeing the project interventions, more than 9,000, 10,000 people have done this on their own, because they saw that there is a good benefit for the purpose of production. Now, another project I will be telling you about, community-based tank management project implemented in Andhra Pradesh. As Dr. Das and others were telling, even the Mehra was telling, this is the further development is in a reservoirs. So this project, AP Community Tank Development Projects, the concept is that because of siltations, there is no water into the tank. So that silt has been taken out, and this water storage was there. Because of the storage is there, then canals can be provided the water. So agriculture can develop. So agriculturists, we can get the water. Then for the people, those who want a drinking water also, wherever it is not available, they can get it. Even for the veterinary, for the animals, they can get the water. And for the fisheries purpose, same water is being used for that. So this concept was developed for whole development of the village. And the laborers who doesn't have a land into that, they can take up the fisheries as well. Such people has been selected into that. Wherever the fisheries cooperative societies is there, that societies can take up. But wherever fisheries cooperative society is not there, the landless laborer can be taken and put into the group. And they form common interest group into that. And this project also, the production earlier, the project was hardly 125 kilogram per hectare per year, which has been enhanced to about 500 kilogram per hectare. Of course, it is not very big, but it is small. These are not the big people. They are, because these are the farmers, those who are not seen even fisheries also earlier. They were trained into that and then have been developed into that. Here, the what are the initiatives taken is that the big size stocking of seed. Seed is a quality seed has been put into that. Same the training. Training is not at the room site, but it is the farm. They have been taken to the farm, and whenever is required, they can be given training at the farm site itself. Then here we have experimented that the subsidy is given in 1 year only, so people will be attracted to do it. But we have given for the 3 years, first year 75%, second year 50%, third year 25%. And very important is the support to the marketing. Because marketing is very important. Now, at the place like Hyderabad, they can have a set up a sort of a kiosk or a stall like that. And because each group, now Monday, X group will bring the fish, Tuesday, another group will bring the fish, so that we have provided the facility to them and the marketing was done. So this way, it was helpful to them. Now, these are the things which we are doing it. Now a new project has been there, but everybody is talking about the cage culture is concerned. So now third project we are taking is the Johar, that is Jharkhand State Opportunities for Harnessing Rural Growth. This project is just taken from the last, 2 years into that. And this project is main component is these farm ponds. Under horticulture mission, very small ponds have been prepared into that for the storing of water so they can give it to the crops. These ponds also can be taken for the fish farming, and they have taken up about lakhs of farms. Fish ponds have been converted, but this is not very, it is very seasonal. It may not grow very big fish, but whatever 300, 400, 500 kilograms they can grow it, it will enhance the food security is concerned. The third is we have taken the cage culture. There, of course, everybody is talking, Mr. Das and others, this cage culture in this project. About 100 cages that will be taken into the reservoirs. Then third aspect is the pen culture, which is not practiced in India more. So that we wanted to take through the institutional finance into that. And in this pen culture, mostly the pangasius is done, but we are of the opinion that pangasius is, of course, a marketing problem is concerned, because already Das and others has already highlighted the problems into that. Maybe tilapia can be taken into that and see that how it can be developed into that. Now, these are the three projects which are as a model into that as a development. Now, based on that, I have identified some issues for the future development. What issues can be taken? First issue is definitely the river stocking. Of course, he said ranching. It's a scientific word called the ranching into that. But the increase the production into the fish, because it's a small people. This is the livelihood for them. And for, so that river stocking can be done. Second one is long-term leasing of the water bodies. Most of the states, the Gram Panchayat doesn't lease the water bodies for the long term. It is only for 1 year is taken. So the people doesn't have interest. So it should be leased for the longer period. In case of banking, it is very important now, especially for the COVID. This aspect is very important, because reschedulement is to be done for the loan. So that they can have, and flexible repayment period. It is not like that our EMI every month we can give the money to the banks. There should be flexible repayment into that. That should be done into that. Fourth issue is the insurance. Though this the insurance companies, national insurance companies, they have that insurance package for that, but they are not insuring into that. So in this respect, I request this commission, this joint secretary for that, they can have a sort of a dialogue with them, and for the fisheries, insurance should be there. Even if necessary, NFDP can put into the some funds as a premium, 1 or 2, 3% less into that, and that can be done so that, like a, when any difficulties like a COVID comes, this insurance can be useful for that. The fourth aspect is the human resources development. Now, this is very important. When you go to the village, in a schools, what is being taught in the present education is like a geography, history, and Hindi, English, and all that. But that school is just behind or in the agricultural land. Or I saw it on the periphery of Bun, that school is there. But the students, children are not exposed to the fisheries or the agriculture is concerned. But this 80% of these children of that school, that they will be going as a laborers into the field of agriculture or the fisheries and other things is concerned. So there is a need of reforms in the education of the rural education system, that the agriculture, fisheries, that is natural resources sciences should be taught into the schools into that. That's a basic reforms will be required to develop the sector agriculture and fisheries is concerned into that. Then the very important is the awareness building of the fish. Fish is a good protein. It is, useful for the, even this cardio patients can be taken into that. So how to develop the awareness need to be developed. You know, on the TVs, you find Sunday, Monday, Roj Khao and Day. Like this, there will be advertisement in it. Dood, 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 India, dood, pita. But you don't find any advertisement for awareness for the fisheries product is concerned. Maybe that may be required, but maybe the government of India, NFDB and all, they can think over it and can put the awareness campaign for that. The seventh is this avail opportunity to attract funds, because as you know, the government doesn't have much funds now. Already they say because of COVID and because of other things is concerned. So we need, because earlier I find it 1986, this exclusive project from the World Bank and IFAD and others is concerned for the fisheries. Now in 90 there was a brackish water fisheries project. In 80s there was only the one inland fisheries project. After that there is no special projects for the fisheries is concerned for international institutions are concerned. So maybe like a saline water, which Mr. Mehra was talking about saline water project. Maybe such type of projects can be put for the international funding is concerned. That, you know, in Maharashtra there is a climate resilient agriculture project is there, having the investment of 599 million, but it doesn't cover the fisheries. I would request that Mr. Devre, that the some sort of fisheries component also can be added into that, so that the development, because they can attract the funds for the purpose of fisheries is concerned. Now, last but the least, there is a need for the research on certain aspects, like a new areas coming up in the world scenario is that aquaponics. In a small area, you can get the 10 tons of production, 20 tons of productions into that, or recirculating systems is concerned. This research institute, like a brackish water and other research institutes, they should concentrate and we should go for this sort of research in that, so that the productivity can help. Once again, I thanks for calling me for that and giving me apology. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir, for sharing such detailed information about the projects. And I'm sure a lot of people on this panel and the participant will take a cue and will work on those and will avail some benefits. So, you know, there are some people who forayed into inland farming, inland fisheries, after they have a successful career in different, segments. So one such farmer we have with us today is Mr. Vasant. So Mr. Vasant, can you please unmute him? So Mr. Vasant Ulkande is based out of Nagpur, and he retired from a government job, and now he has taken this particular profession. So Mr. Ulkande, could you please tell us about your journey and opportunities you see post-COVID?
Okay, madam. I am very much thankful to you and organization that you invite me for this webinar. Madam, I am working in fisheries since last 10 years. Actually, I am also manufacturing cages, and I have supplied a lot of cages to in Maharashtra, MP, Chhattisgarh, and Gujarat also. And nowadays, I am focusing on some fun ponds fish culture, that is agro fish culture. Actually, farmers have their own ponds in their agriculture land, and that are unused. Actually, they are using for water storing only. And around the year, they have water storage. But this stored water is not utilized for other purposes, only to provide water to fields. Actually, they can irrigate their lands from wells also. But as government have provided this opportunity to give them ponds, so lot of farmers dig some ponds from the aid of government. I propose these farmers to take fish farming project in their these unutilized water storages. And also some people are doing also in my own farm, which is near to Nagpur, only 18 kilometers from Nagpur. I have set up one system there. I am taking water from my wells to that ponds, and for irrigation, I use that water from my ponds. So I have to use two motor pumps actually, but I am benefited by storing fishes in the farm. The water is already fertigated. So since last 2 years, I have stopped using these fertilizers, inorganic fertilizers. So the water is itself a fertigated water and a byproduct also, because fishes of the fish when are already in water, and that act as fertilizer also. And it is very beneficial for the farmers, because I am getting at 80,000 to 1 lakh rupees per pond net profit per year. So I am now working on this project. There are certain things that I have noticed, that I suggest so many farmers to do this work. Some are working well, and some are failed also. Actually, Upre Sahab said, the farmland, farm ponds should be utilized for this purpose. And if there is one system is created, that one umbrella agency, you can say, that will monitor, that will educate these farmers regarding pond system activities, and also how to maintain pond, and species selection, and also some parts are there that stocking, quantity, species selection, and stocking density, and also feeding of the fish, because feeding is a major aspect in fish farming. In fish cage culture, we see that at least 40 rupees to 45 rupees per kg is the cost for feeding. And this much cost is not affordable for any farmer, or even in fish cage culture. Because I take tilapia, people purchase tilapia from market at the rate of 125 to 150 rupees. But when traders come to farm, they demand it for 50 to 60 rupees kg. So it is not actually a viable project for farmer, because he have to invest operational cost more than the selling price, or there is meager profit remains. If some sort of system is developed that can collect fish from these farmers, and arrange for marketing to them and assist them in marketing, then it will be a good opportunity for farmers to develop their farms, and also they will have some additional income source.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Mehra, you know, since you are on the panel, a lot of people have questions for you. So we have some young entrepreneurs and some people, young people who have started their own units. So would you be kind enough to take one or two questions, or should we just send it to you over an email and then you can
answer? Just one thing before we take on the questions. Just two simple small observations to make, that PMMSY, looking at, creating awareness, brand building, and promoting domestic consumption in a big way. We are looking for developing fish mark, GI in fish, Himalayan trout branding, these kind of things which are coming for first time. And simultaneously, we are working on, I think few of you may be aware that aquatic animal disease and health management bill, because presently there is no regulatory framework to control the inputs, aquaculture inputs, especially what is going into the, at farm level. And there is no gradation of hatcheries, grade A, grade B. There are hatcheries simply. So we are working on different fronts. And so far as risk management, that is crop insurance is concerned, we have already taken up with Oriental Insurance and they are working on few models. And as he suggested, that NFDB has already worked on a scheme that is for shrimp crop insurance, and they have been following up with three or four states. Maharashtra has given their comments, and AP and Kerala, the comments are still awaited. I hope that if we can expedite with the state governments, definitely this scheme for shrimp insurance will definitely pick up. And domestic, apart from export market, domestic market, promoting domestic consumption is an important area which we are for the first time in scheme it has been included, and specific allocation for extension work has been done. This is one thing, and if there are few on the already there on the web, if there are some questions, I am very happy to take on.
Sure, sir. So the first question that I will take from Suchitra Upare. Suchitra, please introduce yourself and ask a question. I believe you have a question for Mr. Sagar Mehra. Suchitra? Suchitra Upare, are you there?
Yes, I'm there.
Okay, I believe you have a question for Sagar Mehra, sir. Could you please introduce yourself and ask the question quickly?
So my name is Suchitra, and I'm also currently working as a consultant with FAO. And we're particularly working on small-scale fisheries sector. And we're trying to see how various, kind of financial instruments can be introduced for risk mitigation, and also to kind of, spur investments in the sector. And coincidentally, this webinar also has kind of come at the right time. And also because of the pandemic that has set in, the kind of work that we are doing has also kind of just synergistically there. So what we've been seeing, and from the kind of, stories and what we've been reading, that because of the pandemic, there's so much of reverse migration that has happened. Also the kind of, the kind of stock that has gone waste during these times. So it's fantastic to see that, this Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana, which is there, which is talking a lot about, boosting the sector in terms of production, which automatically is also going to, which is also going to bring in a lot of livelihoods there. And as you see that major, contributors to these productions is mostly the small scale fishers and the fish farmers, which are there. So we're just trying to understand, sir, that how, as you just mentioned about the insurance factor, But I think there are already a lot of, in terms of, say, for the fishing, there is some insurance component which is there, and I think Oriental or some other companies are doing. But when it comes to aquaculture insurance, sir, there is not much happening over there, just the way it is happening for the agricultural crop insurance. So I think that's where Government of India and Government of Maharashtra and others, you know, we need to focus on that. There are a lot of good models there. Like if you see in the China, there are people, small fishers, group of cluster farmers who are there. They are doing it through a cooperative and a third party insurer, which is there. So I think we need to look into, I can also share information more about this, you know, to you all, as to how these small scale fishers can be, you know, insulated from these kinds of shocks, not just when it happens in pandemic, but also in the future. And this has been one of the major concerns. I've also spoken to one or two entrepreneurs who were, I think they were mentioning somewhere near Mura Dam in Ahmednagar itself. So they also were worried at that point of time, you know, during this pandemic. So that's the only thing which I wanted to bring to the notice.
I agree with you, and we are already seized of the issue involved here. Crop insurance is, I think, to insulate our farmers against any, you know, mishap is must. And we are already, you know, in the process of convening one big workshop with all the insurance players. And I have already spoken to my counterpart in the Department of Financial Services, the insurance portfolio. My minister has already ordered for one big meeting with all the insurance players. So this thing is already on our cards, and we are working actively on it.
Thank you, sir. I'll take one last question for one young entrepreneur, Snehal. Snehal? Snehal Verma? Yes, sir. Please introduce yourself and ask your question quickly.
Yes. Ma'am, am I audible?
Yes, you are. Please go ahead.
Okay. Yes, sir. So, good afternoon, sir. It's a very informative session. I am Snehal, and I'm co-founder director at a young startup, NatureDots, where we have actually created a technological solution for de-risking fisheries, and it's based on deep tech learning, big data technology. So while we were working on the solution, we observed there's a huge data and information gap. And while we are conducting our pilot, we observed that the data can be actually a game changer in the entire fishery value chain. So moving forward and looking forward, sir, for a large-scale implementation, as a lot of issues have been discussed here, how can startups like NatureDots can seek mentoring and guidance from the key decision makers in the fisheries sector in itself to achieve these 2025 targets, which are very ambitious, and I'm very sure that India is positioned because we have high quality of fisheries and some very high-value indigenous fisheries available. So if you could just guide us to how we can connect further and what key schemes or packages are available to support startups in aquatic sector.
First of all, let me tell you that we have provision for, you know, taking up startups in PMMSY itself. So any area and innovative projects, we have been supporting under FIDF also, and then PMMSY also. We will support any project starting from database, any innovative technology, any production technology, any innovative project, and 4 or 5 projects we already supported under FIDF. As I have already told you, that 3 projects were from young entrepreneurs, young scientists we have supported. And because in fisheries we attach, you know, big importance to database. If you have any innovative project even on a database side, like assessing the potential in marine fisheries, in inland fisheries, and how to manage the data, manage production. See, on any front, the summary summary document of PMMSY is already available on our website. You just pick up any of the subject, and you come out with a innovative project. We have provision to support even startups also.
Thank you, sir. Sir, I'll take one last question. It's for Dr. Ravi Shankar. So, Dr. Ravi Shankar, what are the technologies you suggest for maximum catch in inland fisheries? If you can just quickly answer that.
Can you repeat, please?
Yes. What are the technologies you suggest for maximum catch in inland fisheries?
Yeah, see, again, I told you, we need to optimize the fishing technique, okay? Because if it is a reservoir, we need to study it first. Because there can be, you know, deterrents, you know, we cannot simply say gillnet is proper. Whether, even in gillnet, whether it is the bottom set gillnet, whether it is a, you know, a free gillnet. So, all that has to be studied first. So, simply, it cannot be advocated that this is the best technique. Again, the material for the, you know, net what we are using, that is again very, very important. Many times what we are saying, you know, they are using a very thin material which will get entangled, it will get torn and result into environmental degradation and also result in ghost fishing. So, unless we study the water body, we have to optimize the fishing. So, I think probably if somebody is interested, they can approach CAFT in association with CIFRI. We will be very happy to provide all the, you know, technologies. I think they can send a mail to us, directtocaft@gmail.com.
Sir, thank you very much, sir, for your inputs. We have already extended, you know, the time has already been extended. So I would like to now thank all the panelists, sir, for sharing your excellent views and insights about this particular topic. And I would also like to thank all the participants for joining in and, you know, sharing their views and asking questions to all the panelists that we have today with us. And I would also like to add here, one thing is that we have made a note of all the questions that has come to us. So we'll compile all the questions and prepare a resource paper. And the resource paper will be uploaded on the AgroVision website. So we will be, you know, reaching out to all the panelists once again to understand their inputs on the other questions that we have for them. So thank you all of you once again, and really appreciate your time and efforts here. Thank you very much.
Thank you.